There is no question that a tremendous breakthrough has taken place. Also, there's no question that I'm under tremendous pressure and stress and strain. That is true. But this is a great time to press the advantage, actually. So in this video, we're going to go forward with tremendous momentum here, bringing to light the context of the situation that we're in, okay? And this, we're in a tremendous time of opportunity for us. The breakthrough has been occurring more and more for me, and last night was a pinnacle. There's a fly buzzing around, so I'm gonna wave it off. What I discovered is that the scam of light, which is what I call the scam that light is perpetrating on us by our request. See, this is very key. We requested light to convince us that we were greater than God. And so in order to do this, light has been perpetrating this vast and clever scam of self-deception. And the light has been appearing to be in conflict with itself. But what light has also done is it's brought a hero into this dream, this dream, really. And the hero is there to solve the conflict. That too is part of the hoax. That too is part of the self-deception. That's a very important part of it. Because what it's saying is, yes, there is a conflict, but don't worry, it's fixable. Where in fact, there is no conflict with light, that's impossible. God did not create conflict. But there's another part to it also, which is a very clever, even greater depth of this, and that is there's this witness to the dream, the conflict, the apparent conflict of light with light. Light and dark is a conflict of light. Light and dark is a conflict with light. What else could it be? We say there's a conflict with light and dark. There's a hero that is here to heal the sickness, make the world a beautiful place, make this house a home. That's the hero, or heroine actually is the case in these days. It's the goddess heroine, and the maternal aspect is here to solve all our problems of a conflict of the light. That's all a scam. There's the deeper part to it, the witness. There's a witness to all this who's witnessing it. That too is part of the scam. That too is part of the scam. You might even say there's four parts to it, or three or four. There's the conflict, good and bad, light and dark, that supposed conflict. There's the hero, heroine that is here to solve the problems, the mother to calm the children down and make everything okay. There's the witness to all of this. All of that is the scam. The truth is spirit. There's a witness to the witness, to the hero, and that is trying to heal the conflict of the light. Okay, that witness of the witness is where truth really abides. And this witness to all of the witness to the heroine solving the problem of the conflict of good and evil, conflict of light, is not at all convinced. Not at all convinced. And there, that's where the power of decision is. In the witness, to the heroine who is supposedly healing the conflict, supposed conflict of light, okay? That is spirit. That is will, that is choice, that is decision. That is where we need to be centered. That is where. So what I've discovered is the depth of this self-deception, this scam that light is perpetrating on our request is way deeper than we thought. But I will say that the great realizers of the East, some of the great gurus, the great realizers, from ancient times up to modern times, they knew about this. They did know about this. That even this witness, the first witness, that's too delusion. That is too is delusion. And we have not really in the West gotten to this. We have not really gotten to this. We're still caught up in this maternal delusion that we're here like as Big Mother to solve the problems of the world, to solve the problems of this dream. But a dream that is totally fraudulent, has nothing to do with reality, the dream of light being in contact with light, what is there that needs to be healed? The very act of trying to heal this reinforces the belief that the conflict is real. It reinforces this belief, and the witness to all of this, bearing witness to it, is reinforcing the belief that it's consequential and important. So you have this sort of fourfold or threefold, fourfold, whatever you want to say, delusion, self-deception. The witness, that is, which is bearing witness, is saying, this is consequential, this is important, I need to pay attention to this. Oh, here's the mother, here's the divine feminine, here to fix all the problems of this conflict. You see, I need to pay attention to this. And here's this conflict of all this conflict of sickness, all this illness, disease, everything. All of this is a pretense by light. Light is doing all of this as a vast, deep, deceptive pretense, so that the witness to the witness, what spirit can believe, make believe that it's greater than God. That's the whole purpose of it. And the dream, all this dream, is has absolutely no truth to it whatsoever. Light cannot be in conflict with light. There is no such thing as death, sickness, conflict, healing. None of it is real whatsoever. It is nothing but a completely flimsy, non-real, non-existent dream, an hallucination, really. A play of light, light presenting this fantasy play. So we get stuck in many places. We get stuck on the conflict. We get stuck on the belief in the divine feminine here is here to solve this conflict. We get stuck on that. We get stuck on the witness, thinking that just being a witness or observer, that is the answer. So we get stuck on all of that. The way to get unstuck is where we need to first realize that we're stuck. This isn't it. This is not it. And we have a continuity problem between the first witness and the true witness. And the true witness is simply believing that this proves that this is the experience of being prime creator. It's the experience. All right, he's believing that. He says, look at this, look at all of this. There's a great continuity problem between the first witness and realizing that too is not it. That's too part of the deception. And then the true witness to all this, which is spirit. There's a continuity gap there. This is what we need to bridge. This is where the focus has to be. It has to come off of all the other places that it's been. There's tremendous focus in this world now on the conflict, on the divine feminines, on being the witness to this. That's where all of the focus is. But keep in mind, it's light that has the focus on all of this. That's part of the deception, is light trying to heal the conflict, light trying to witness to this conflict. That is part of the dream. That is part of the dream. So we're trying to solve the situation at a place where it can't be solved at all. We're just being duped, completely duped. By this, which is what we ask for. When we ask to be God, we're asking to be completely duped. And we most certainly have been completely duped. And yet, this being duped is not real, right? That we are still spirit. And we're still exactly as God created us. We are free. We are not a body. We are not form. We're formless. There's nothing in this dream that reminds us of what we truly are at all. So, how do we get this bridge? You know, how do we resolve the continuity fear that we have? Because ultimately we have to realize this whole dream was nothing but self-deception, nothing but deception, nothing but pretense. Light never died. Light is not in conflict with light. Light has not changed. Light is still perfectly, equally responsive to all. There's no specialness whatsoever. On and on and on and on and on. So nothing in the dream is true. So how do we drop the dream? Well, that's the continuity fear. So we need an intermediate step to dropping this dream. And this is where our focus needs to be. Otherwise, we're not going to get the answer. We're not going to get free. We're not going to be willing to drop this nonsense. We won't know who we are, really. We're not the first witness. We are not. We are not. Yet we think we are. And we're not the heroine, the divine feminine, the mother principle, healing the conflict. We are not that either. We are not that. Spirit has nothing to do with any divine feminine principle or divine male principle. It has nothing to do with mother or father or paternalism or motherism or whatever. Nothing to do with that. Absolutely nothing to do with any of that whatsoever. No connection or relation whatsoever. That's all part of this dream. Jesus says a way to think of what we are. He says that we're like just a puff of a breeze, like just a soft breeze, really. That's more like what we are than any of this other nonsense. Totally free, complete, total freedom of spirit, absolute formless spirit. So this other stuff is nothing but absolute nonsense, really, in the dream. Total nonsense. You know, the matriarchy, the patriarchy, male, female bodies, absolute nonsense. It has zero to do with what we truly are. And has nothing to do with our healing, actually, with our evaporation of the continuity problem. It has nothing to do with it. What we need to do, well, we need to focus on what the problem is, and then we need to come up with, realize what the answer is. And so this is what I'm here for. This is my purpose, is to focus where the answer, where the problem really is, and therefore what the answer needs to be applied to. We need to see formless light, the presence of equal light, just the light, formless light. Its quality is equal presence. Its quality is equal responsiveness. And stop reifying this light as male or female or anything like that. Get completely off of that. We have to get in a post-concretized, post-reified, post-witness state, and simply use the witnessing condition to bear witness to this light. Not trying to use the light for anything is very important. We've got to go beyond this idea of healing. Okay, that only makes the problem worse. We need to realize there's nothing that needs to be healed. What kind of healing needs to take place in a dream? It only reinforces the dream. It says the sickness is real, but I can use the light to heal it. That actually makes things worse. We need to say the sickness is not real, therefore it doesn't need any healing. And we don't need to bear any witness to any healing whatsoever. Getting our mind off of healing is the answer, actually. Getting our mind onto simply the light itself as it is. Formless light, formless light. And forget about the world. Take our attention off the world altogether. Altogether. It's like someone waking from a dream, taking their attention off of the dream. Now, the intermediate step would be a dream within the dream, or a dream of awakening. But that dream awakening needs to be formless, needs to have a formless quality to it, as primary quality is formless. It is not identified with bodies or genders or any sort of, you know, anything like that. Qualities, is it male, is it female, is it feminine qualities, masculine qualities, all that stuff has to go. The light, because the light is truly, you might call it, perfectly neutral. It's perfect, forever neutrality, as it were. perfect responsiveness is totally neutral, absolute neutrality, or absolute nothingness, absolute no qualityness, absolute neutrality, etc. And so we're only now getting to this, at least I am. I realize that there's not a lot here, you know, not a lot in the world now that are getting to this, actually. In the past, it has been gotten to this absolute high indifference, this total detachment from the world, this total living in the light, living in the light, living as the light, realizing that this is all complete pretense. Everything that we are perceiving and think we're experiencing, it's the light that's experiencing, telling us that it's experiencing all this. We're not even in this at all. It's like a movie. Spirit's not in this at all. This body, the witness, the world, all of this is just like a dream. We're not really in this dream at all. We're only, all is universal being. It can't be in anything. It cannot be in anything. It's impossible. There is no inness, so to speak. There is no outness, but there's also no inness. The notion that somehow we're in a dream is impossible. Light is presenting this dream, and light is acting as if it's in the dream, as a body, as a person, as a heroine, as a witness. That's all light doing this incredibly creative pretense. None of it's true. It doesn't matter what happens in the dream at all. It's all completely bogus. Again, the idea that there's some inwardness. There's no inwardness. There's no outwardness. That's duality. To say that there's something inner is duality. We can't be in anything. All is universal being. All is universal being. We need to come out of duality. And what we're really in is spiritual duality. Spiritual duality. Okay, and this is what we need to jettison. This is the tool that's dragging us down. Now, it seems like a very good tool, right? Very helpful tool. I want to be a healer. I want to use the light to heal sickness. You know, that this is the paradigm that we're stuck in, actually, in the West, especially. And I can do a little history lesson here about the situation we're in. So let's try that 1 minute. Now, we in the West and modern world, which is spread over the culture, spread over the whole planet, may not realize we're trapped in an extremely extreme spiritual dualism, but we are. And that is why we're not able to truly get free, to be understand our freedom, accept our freedom. We're in the spiritual dualism, thinking that we're doing great things for the world. Okay, now, 1870, what happened in 1875, the United States of America? What happened? Let's take a look at what happened. And this is Mary Baker Eddy, who published Science and Health with Key to Scriptures in 1875. I believe she was in Boston, Massachusetts, and he established a church of Christian Science. Super, super influential person. Okay, Mary Baker Eddy. And you cannot underestimate her influence, actually. This was very, very, very successful and popular, and she had many students, many came to her, and they in turn sort of created this momentum, this great domino effect. Now, Mary Baker Eddy was stuck in this paradigm of using the light to heal. Okay, the divine light, needed to be healed by using the light to drive out the malignant animal magnetism here. But she put it into a sort of an absolute framework. Okay, the framework that she used sounded great, but the application of it was very much a healing mission. Which is understandable, because back then, you know, they didn't have the surgery, they didn't have the pharmacology, you know, to treat all these illnesses and diseases and everything. So essentially, it said, look, spiritual healing is possible. Here's why it's possible. And let's go out and heal the world. We can heal the world through this. Now, as consequential as Mary Baker Eddy was, there was someone that was even more consequential. If I could dig up the picture here. Okay. Even more consequential than Mary Baker Eddy. Okay. Let's see if you know who this is. This is Emma Curtis Hopkins, who established the Christian Science Theological Seminary in Chicago in 1886. And this was one of the greatest spiritual teachers that the West has had, actually. She was an extremely good teacher, a great teacher of the principles of Christian Science. But she went a step further and taught a more unitive sort of teaching. However, the emphasis was still on healing. But it was on healing at perhaps a higher level of healing. Now, she had many, many students, and those students went on to popularize what's called as New Thought. New Thought. Emma Curtis Hopkins was really the founder of New Thought. She was a student of Mary Baker Eddy's. They had a split, because Mary Baker Eddy was a control freak, let's be honest. And she wanted to say that, you know, only her teachings had relevance, and that they came only from her. But actually, Phineas Quimby, she got many of the teachings from Phineas Quimby. But so she had some issues, Mary Baker Eddy. Now, Emma Curtis Hopkins was able to convey a powerful sense of oneness and unity to her students, and so they went off and established all sorts of movements. One of the movements, let's see if you recognize this. This is Charles Fillmore, and he founded the Unity Movement in 1889. He was one of Emma Chris Hopkins' students, along with his wife Myrtle Fillmore, founded Unity, which is still the Unity Church, Unity. And Unity, interesting enough, is we'll get to that. There were some other people, that New Thought people, for instance. This is another person who's popular in New Thought movement, which is Joel Goldsmith. Joel Goldsmith, The Infinite Way, published Infinite Way in 1947. There's also many, many New Thought teachers. Many. Marie Watts is my favorite, and she doesn't have any picture. I can't give you a picture. Marie Watts in 1957 published a book, and it was the Ultimate Way. She started publishing books, and my favorite is You Are the Splendor. Came across that when I was young. This massive New Thought movement in the United States and spreading throughout the world in many ways had it at its emphasis healing, 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 healing. Okay. And interesting enough, A Course in Miracles came out of this New Thought movement in many ways and found fertile ground, and many people who were educated in New Thought are able to transition over the course. And you know, I'm one of those. I grew up in the New Thought movement. Ernest Holmes is another, a science of mind. Both my grandmothers were very much in the New Thought movement, both of them, extremely involved in the New Thought movement, as were a great number of women throughout this country, actually. It was essentially a feminist movement. It was the founding of feminism in a lot of ways, in a spiritual way, because Emma Curtis Hopkins had this belief that in the divine feminine, that women were spiritually superior to men, and that there was a new age coming, and that it would be the age of the divine feminine, where the matriarchy would rule the planet and be the golden age of spiritual contemplation. Now, as a matter of fact, she did not originate this idea. This idea was originated, and I will show you and see if you know who this is. This is Joachim of Fiore. Okay, this is a painting of him. A super, super influential person in history, actually. And most people don't know that. He's the one in 1184 who posited this theory of the three ages. And he said the first age was the age of the patriarchs, which is based on fear and greed and obedience to religion. Obedience based on fear. The second age was the age of the sun, which was Jesus Christ initiated that, which is an age of greater understanding and clarification and tolerance. And then the third age is called the age of the Holy Spirit, which would be an age of no need for any institutions whatsoever, a golden age of contemplation, of everyone would be renunciates, so to speak, and living in monasteries and nunneries and spiritual retreats, and they would spend their time in contemplation. There'd be no need for any religious authority whatsoever. This is his theory, and he brought this theory into the Middle Ages, and it was very, very popular. He was one of the greatest apocalyptic writers in history, along with John in the Gospels, the Revelation of John. And he thought he had understood the revelation of John and how it would play out. And so he put this theory out, extremely popular. It was championed by some of the people in the Middle Ages, for instance. It was championed by Dante. This is Dante Alighieri, who wrote, of course, the Divine Comedy. And he put Joachim in paradise and agreed with, you know, he thought his theories were correct. His theories were refuted by Thomas Aquinas in his Summa Theologica, which is in 1268 was published. Now, Joachim of Fiore said that the third age would start in 1260, the third age of this divine rule by the light of the Holy Spirit, where people would not need religious authority anymore, okay? And this would be a time of this great spiritual awakening. Everyone would spend their times in contemplation and realization. 1260 was when said that would start, 1260. Now, Thomas Aquinas refuted this in 1265, and it was officially declared an anathema and not a true writings were said as not to be true by the church. And of course, that age did not happen. It did not happen. Now, very interestingly, okay, Emma Curtis Hopkins, in a Chicago, the Christian Science Theological Seminary in Chicago in 1886, started her teaching, and she had a great number of students, most of them women. Out of the first graduating class, I think all of them are women. She picked up on this theory of Joachim of Fiore, and she championed it, and she said that the third age is starting now. When she was teaching, this is the third age, and is to be ruled by women. And says that the Holy Spirit actually is the divine feminine principle, the Great Mother. Okay, she calls the Holy Spirit the Great Mother, and that this new age, the feminism would usher in this new age of perfect spiritual perfection here on earth. So New Thought, at its very inception, with Mary Baker Eddy and Curtis Hopkins, was profoundly feminist in orientation, profoundly believing that women were going to solve the problems of the world, that this new age would be ruled by women, by the divine feminine, and this would solve all problems. It would heal all afflictions, solve all problems. All of this, of course, was set in a context of absolute oneness. Okay, this is the strange duality that's been taking place in this world. Now, of course, the miracles came along, and it fit in nicely to this in some ways. But actually, the Course in Miracles, it's not dualistic. It's not dualistic. It's actually ushering in what? Transcendence of duality, spiritual duality. But the movement of New Thought, the New Thought movement, is profoundly feminist, profoundly. And this continues where the participation in a lot of this New Thought is, you know, overwhelmingly from women. And so it has an overwhelmingly bias or it tips towards this belief that feminism, divine feminine, is the answer to our problems here. And this is really the undercurrents of this modern time, is this belief. It also comes from Theosophy, which was founded by none other than Madame Blavatsky, woman, Alice Bailey, another woman. Annie Besant, extreme woman, feminist, and a combination of Theosophy and New Thought is the foundation of the modern New Age movement, actually. And it's all uses the language of oneness. Okay, it uses the language of oneness. Emma Curtis Hopkins, I think she's a fabulous teacher. I mean, I think her teachings are the words at least. Tremendous, absolutely tremendous. Marie Watts is maybe even better. Marie Watts was truly, I think, very realized. But she didn't go for this feminist divine mother thing. So nobody knows about her hardly. There's not even a single picture of her anywhere. She's not on Wikipedia. Yeah, but for my money, you know, that you know, she was one of the a great spiritual realizer, Marie Watts, actually. You are the splendor. You know, like the ultimate of this New Thought movement. The New Thought movement has a lot of good teaching in it, but it's dualistic, and it's still dualistic. It's light fooling light. It's a pretense, because it emphasizes the idea of healing the planet. Okay, this is spiritual dualism. This is the problem that we have. So how do you not throw the baby out with the bathwater? Well, you can't put new wine into old wineskins. You know, it just doesn't work. It doesn't work. And it's interesting to note that all these women in New Thought and pushing this whole theosophy, New Thought, etc., men in those movements are just servants, actually. They're just a means to help move things along. That they wouldn't have all the free time to travel, to move around, to do all the stuff, if it weren't for the massive labor of men building roads, building cars, building airplanes, building bridges, building railroad tracks, working themselves to death to produce all this abundance and modern ease, etc. You know, and so of course there's all these women of means and leisure and wealth and capability who could spend their whole lives studying all this stuff, traveling everywhere, you know, and attending all these meetings, right? Whereas the men were working themselves to death, trying to provide for a beautiful house, beautiful car, vacations, provide the money and the means, desperately, you know, fighting, struggling over the resources of the world to make this all possible, to make it all possible. They haven't gotten a single, you know, bit of respect or thanks for any of that, really. They're just an afterthought. That's been my experience almost 58 years in this world, being immersed in New Thought, New Age, all this stuff. It's all about women. It's all about women. Men, they're just, you know, kind of like to do whatever needs to be done to advance this thing, but no respect whatsoever. No respect whatsoever, actually. Just all that I've experienced my whole life is men getting dumped on. That's it. They're the cause of all the problems. The patriarchy, all the problems, they caused all the problems. Just get out of the way. If you can help us, great. But we're here to save the world. That's the ideology. This is spiritual dualism. This is a fraud. This is a hoax. This is part of the hoax that light is playing, that we need to save the world. That is spiritual dualism. There is no world to save. There is no sickness to heal. The idea that there's a sickness to heal is total delusion. Total delusion. The idea that there's some sort of something that needs to be healed or fixed is delusion. So we've had this teaching that sounds great. Theosophy, new thought, sounds great on the surface. But we've had plenty of time now to have hindsight and look at the situation. It hasn't worked. It hasn't worked. In fact, the world is in much worse situation than it's ever been right now. We're not going into a golden age. We're going into disaster. And spiritual healing is been replaced with pharmaceuticals, right? I mean, the pharmaceutical industry and the big med and all this stuff has got control of the planet. Let's face it. Let's not hide our head in the sands. I mean, legally, you know, Christian Science trying to heal through prayer, etc., is now being termed a felony all over the planet. Now, I used to believe in all that stuff, but somehow it didn't work. Something was wrong. There's something wrong. And A Course in Miracles came along to try and fix this, to enlighten us to this situation, to the shortcomings of new thought, actually, shortcomings of theosophy. But, of course, the momentum of all that just steamrolled into A Course in Miracles and basically tried to twist it into new thought. So yeah, a lot of the people who are out there teaching A Course in Miracles are really just teaching new thought. Okay, it's still dualistic, very dualistic, and there a lot of this idea of the divine feminine is trying to creep into A Course in Miracles, which is not in there at all. It's not in there at all. That's new thought being pushed. Okay, that's Emma Curtis Hopkins pushing feminism and pushing the belief in this new age that is to be ruled by the matriarchy, the divine feminine, which she terms as the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has nothing to do with the divine feminine or matriarchy or anything. The Holy Spirit has no gender whatsoever. Now, I understand what she was talking about. And she said, well, it's like a mother. It's really patient. It's always there. Yeah, but saying something is like a mother and then taking it to be the mother is called reification, concretizing. That is a huge mistake. A huge mistake. And that mistake is playing out now on the world stage in a most unwelcome way, actually. Disasters. I mean, men are being turned into slaves. Nothing more than slaves. And men are being asked to participate in this spiritual scene of the world as tokens. Tokens. Like a black at a white, all-white country club, essentially. Oh, yeah, sure, we got one of those. We got one of those. So I won't have anything to do with that. Absolutely won't have anything to do with that. It's perpetrating a fraud. It's perpetrating spiritual duality, okay, which is the belief that there's something that needs to be healed. That's duality. That's spiritual duality. It just makes things worse. And I, for sure, things have gotten way worse in this world. So, A Course in Miracles was giving us a heads up on all this. Now, Big Pharma is not going to stand for the world suddenly saying, hey, everybody, well, just everyone's just going to do spiritual healing. They're rigging the laws to an extreme extent. There's an enormous conflict there. They have so much power in this world. Now, I said, you know, one of the suggestions, instead of some golden age in this world, how about simply those who want to transcend duality ascend to a place where there's no need for any healing? What they will see is a world where there's absolutely no need for healing whatsoever. This is called the death-free realms. I've been to the death-free realms in spirit. I've seen it, and it's fantastic. That is where true contemplation can take place. Okay. Of course, Big Mother says, hey, don't worry, we're going to solve all your problems. No, there aren't any problems to solve, actually. So, but try to teach that in this world now, which is extremely feminist oriented in its institutions, actually, way more than we realize, with this idea that women are here to solve the problems of the world, and try to say there are no problems. Well, they say you have a war against women, you're undermining women or something. No, women are undermining truth by claiming that this dream is real and it needs to be healed. That's all part of the deception of light. Okay, it's part of self-deception, which is keeping us trapped in duality. Keeping us trapped in duality. Feminism is keeping us trapped in duality, is the primary entrapment method of the times. So yes, New Thought, the teachings were really great in a lot of ways. It's not like I'm ignorant of the teachings, you know, and I can give the same teachings, but in a non-dualistic way, which is important, very important. Now, I'm not part of the A Course in Miracles community or anything like that, because, again, there's just a tremendous attempt to turn A Course in Miracles into New Thought, which is essentially feminist, okay, which is belief in the Divine Mother. And there's some quote-unquote teachers of A Course in Miracles who blatantly have said that the role of men is to serve women. That's it. That women are here to usher in a new age and to heal all the problems, and men's role is to actually worship women. That's actually what one of these so-called teachers of A Course in Miracles said, that the role of men is to worship women, and that's how men are healed. Okay, this is, you know, incredible spiritual dualism. This is total deception of the light. Okay. And yet this is being lapped up by, but remember, this whole thing is a hoax being perpetrated by light. People, personalities, world, conflict, healing of the problems, witnessing to this is all part of this one hoax that light is presenting to us per our request, so that we can believe, spirit can believe, that it is greater than God. That's the whole purpose of it all. So the more you try to claim that you're going to heal the problems of the world, the more you're being deceived. The more you're being deceived. The fact is, there are no problems to be healed whatsoever. There are absolutely no problems to be healed whatsoever. Light is, it's light that is pretending to heal the problems of light. Through the agencies of bodies and personalities and spiritual movements, all that stuff is light pretending to heal the pretend problem of light, which doesn't exist. And then witnessing to this healing and solving of the problem which doesn't exist. So it's a fake healing of a fake problem and a fake witnessing to all of this that is taking place. Now, A Course in Miracles tries to offer us a certain way, maybe a number of ways, actually. One of them is relationship, because it realized that really, in the Western world and around the globe now, women rule the roost more than they ever have. They've come out of the closet. I mean, they've always ruled the roost, but they've come out of the closet and are absolutely dominating. And A Course in Miracles suggested that relationships needed to be forgiven within relationships. So this gives a way, I think, for women to transcend this spiritual dualism and stop buying into this fraud that light is presenting to them, like, hey, you can be the divine feminine, you can solve the problems of the conflict here. That's all fraudulent. It gives women a way to gracefully, not women, quote unquote, but spirit, a way to gracefully say, wow, let me back away from this. But because we're so because of the continuity problem, and we're so believing that the witness to this is really us, that there needs to be some sort of, you know, play of this taking happening. Jesus calls a dream within a dream. So it's a way to kind of for women to come down off their throne, really. But then for spirit, as this happens, spirit will say, well, wait a minute, maybe this is all a hoax. Now wait a minute, maybe the witness too is a hoax. And then it happens like that. It happens like that. So there is this awakening that Jesus talks about. Very clear. But in order to get to this awakening, Jesus says, socially, it's okay for stuff socially to seem to happen, right? To seem to happen. But that ultimately, that leads to breakthroughs. Okay, it leads to breakthroughs. You don't want to institutionalize it. Okay, don't institutionalize it. See, when you try to when you go along the institutionalization that light is doing, then you're really getting sucked into severe delusion, misidentification. That's why A Course in Miracles is supposed to be self-study. Self-study, okay? It's not supposed to be institutionalized. It's not supposed to be institutionalized. You're supposed to study it on your own. You're supposed to apply it on your own to your situation. And it's supposed to lead to breakthroughs. What I've experienced with the Holy Spirit, and I've never experienced the slightest feminine quality, the slightest masculine quality of the Holy Spirit whatsoever. Has absolutely no interest in any of that whatsoever. Is breakthroughs. I've experienced breakthroughs. And that's shifts. Where you say, well, wait a minute. Maybe none of this matters. You know, it's like shifts like that. And it's just like contextual shifts, landscape shifts. The whole spiritual landscape changes. Has a new context, a new interpretation. Like Muji, for instance, like 80% of the people around Muji, I did a count. I said, wait, this is totally dominated by women. I say, where are the men? The men are in the background, the back of the room, off to the side. And you can just tell they're here because their girlfriend wanted to come, their wife wanted to come mostly. And they're just in support of that, you know. And Muji's like, wow, you know. He's kind of like, this is great, but I'm not quite sure you're getting it. I don't think he quite understands the intensity of the New Thought movement, the Theosophical movement, and the modern feminism, this whole aberration of believing that women are the answer. They believe that they're here to heal. They're here to solve the problems. And he said, you say, wait, there isn't any problem, you know. I like Muji. I like her. What's not to like? And yet we understand that there is this, you know, dynamic. There's this dynamic. And I'm not saying he's enlightened or he isn't enlightened or anything, but there is this dynamic. And it's kind of like those who know there is no problem to solve, you know, it's all delusion. It's like all these women show up and say, yeah, we're here. Just tell us, give us our marching orders. We're here. We're the ones here to solve the problem. And you say that there isn't any problem. What are you talking about? And they say, oh, no. No, you're here to help us. You're a figurehead. You know, and we're going to go out and say, yes, we're teaching. We study with Muji. And you know, so there's all these women trying to get it. They go to the, you know, Punduji, they go to these teachers, these non-dual teachers, to get it so they can then go out and say, I'm here to heal the world. I'm here to heal the world. This is all a scam. It's all a scam. And it's not our, it's the light is, this is the play of light to keep us thinking that we're prime creator, that we're greater than God. Keep what? Spirit believing this. Keep spirit's attention. Keep spirit's attention on this play. I mean, is any teacher that comes out is like hordes of locusts. These women descend upon them. And they're all fired up because they're very adept at language and manipulating concepts and language. And they've got all the New Age, New Thought, Of Course in Miracles, Advaita, non-dual language. They're good at saying this, yeah. And they say, okay, I just need to be empowered. So what they're trying to do is bring down the light to heal the world. Like the Mother Mira over in Europe, same thing. I'm bringing down the light. Sri Aurobindo, same thing. I'm bringing down the light. Mother of Pondicherry, same thing. Okay. This is This is the play of light to say I'm bringing down the light. We don't need to bring down any light. What are you talking about? It's all light. There's no need. There's no lack of light anywhere. We need to get to the root of it, which is Spirit requested light. Spirit said, I desire to be greater than God. Requested then light to fool Spirit, to put on this self-deceptive play. So the idea of we need more light, we need to bring light down, we need to be enlightened, all this, that is the play of light, that is the deception. We don't need to be enlightened. Nothing needs to be enlightened. Light is equally responsive even now. There's no more and less whatsoever. Everything's perfect. Everything is absolutely perfect. Now, genuine teacher Sri Ananda Maima, who is not a feminist, even though she did participate in giving the sacred thread to women, and in some ways didn't undermine feminism. She didn't support it, she didn't undermine it. She did say it's important that women do take the spiritual path, okay? But she was not fooled by any of this. She was not fooled by it. She said, everything is absolutely perfect. What are you talking about? There's nothing wrong whatsoever. Nothing has to happen. Nothing has to happen whatsoever. She did not support even though a lot of women came to see her and they said, we got to build hospitals, we got to do charities, we got to solve the problems of the world. She wasn't interested. Was not interested. That's legit. That's really legit. I see her and Marie Watts, I see two very legit teachers. Not my mom was greater than Marie Watts, but Marie Watts, well, they're born in 1896, the same year. They're born the same year. Marie Watts, very obscure. Lived in Nevada, I think, in a little town in Nevada. And traveled around, did some teaching. Extremely obscure, but again, there's nothing wrong. There's absolutely nothing wrong. This is all a play of light. There's something wrong, and something needs to be fixed. Is the deception. Nothing needs to be fixed. All that has to happen is Spirit to get its attention off of this dream and say to light, hey, I repent. I don't want to try to be prime creator anymore. And so I need an intermediate step. So I just want to see light, equal presence of light everywhere. Vision of oneness. So Ananda Maima said, you cannot awaken truly to your true nature except through the vision of oneness. You need the vision of oneness. You have to see all as one. There's no exception. Same thing that Jesus says. You must have the vision of oneness. This is absolutely true. In the vision of oneness, you realize there's nothing wrong whatsoever. There's never been anything wrong. No one's ever suffered. There's never been any suffering. There's never been any death. Nothing has ever happened to us. Light has always been perfect. This is the end of spiritual dualism. So, our problem is we have this tool that we think is going to dig down and solve the problems. Enables us to solve the problems of the world. And we're so gung-ho as a world on solving problems. And no matter what spiritual teacher arises, it seems they get pushed into this, yeah, you know, we're here to solve the problems of the world. Like Eckhart Tolle, you know, hooks up with Oprah, who's of course a huge force for feminism and the divine feminine and solving the problems of the world. Hugely spiritual dualistic force in the world. And you know, that gets pulled into that. It seems whatever comes up in the world, it gets sucked into this black hole of spiritual dualism. And if you say there are no problems, people say, what are you talking about? Look at all the children starving or something. Well, who are the children? And who is reporting that the children are actually, that starvation is real? You know, look into this deeper, and you can actually have breakthroughs and realize this is all a fraud, a hoax. The whole world of form is a hoax by light. There isn't anything but light. Is light starving? Is light starving? Is light suffering? Is pretending to starve? Is pretending to suffer? But it's not. It's not. It's not. Now, it's true that Christian Science, New Thought, etc., the teaching at its root says there is no sickness. It's impossible for there to be any sickness at its root. But it still gets caught up in this mother thing of I need to heal the child. The child, my child is sick, I need to heal the child. No, can't do that. That sucks you into spiritual dualism. But of course, women giving birth to all this form, quote unquote, really, we're not, women are part of the light, this play of light too. They're not giving birth. This light is pretending to give birth to light, claiming its form. And then there's this all this attachment saying, well, I've got to make this, you know, person happy. I've got to make sure they're not sick and all this stuff. All the play of the light, the entire thing. But it's at this level of the mother giving birth to children, raising the children, trying to make things well. It's at that area that the witness, this fake witness, is focused on. And so spirit spirit's attention is drawn to this because this fake witness is saying, yeah, this is it, this is super important. This is why our attention is still attached, drawn to this dream. Is because we think something important is happening, something significant is happening. The mother is here to heal the child, etc. Okay. This is the problem. This is spiritual dualism. And so because of this, I've never been welcome in New Thought or A Course in Miracles or any place in this world because I'm carrying this breakthrough within my will to cast aside spiritual dualism. Ascend to the death-free realms. Do not keep this mockery going of that there's some real problem somewhere. No such thing as a real problem, except a practical problem. There is such a thing as a practical problem in terms of the continuity problem. That is definitely true. Because how do we go from believing all of this is real to realizing there was never a shred of reality to it whatsoever? The inequality of light, the problems of light, the conflict of light, sickness, death, not a shred of truth to any of it. How do we go from totally believing in it to not a shred of truth to it ever whatsoever? Continuity problem, huge problem, huge problem. So the Holy Spirit is evaporating this problem in different ways. Okay, I'm not against New Thought or Christian Science or A Course in Miracles or whatever, any spirit. I'm not against any of that. But I understand, I'm able to see that it gets sucked back into spiritual duality. Okay, because we keep thinking that something needs to be fixed and the witness is interested in this fixing. This is a false witness. Okay, I think that the greatest problem is this false witness to all of this. We think that that's spirit witnessing to it. It's not. So I think the whole emphasis needs to shift over to this false witness. And I don't think we're ready to drop this false witness quite yet. Very few have. Those are the great realizers like Shankara and Buddha, etc. It seems as though what Jesus is talking about is an intermediate step where this false witness witnesses the presence of light, the vision of oneness. Now, once this false witness is witnessing to the vision of oneness, what happens eventually is both the false witness and the vision of oneness are both dropped simultaneously together. There's no more need for that. And that's true awakening. That's true acceptance of our true nature as spirit, infinite freedom, infinite perfect formlessness, infinite freedom. That's the final awakening, which God takes care of itself. But our purpose is here is for this false witness to the vision of oneness, which is the equal presence of light. This is what A Course in Miracles, in my opinion, is pointing us towards. This is what the Holy Spirit is pointing me towards, and the breakthroughs the Holy Spirit has given me is for this step to take place. This frees us from spiritual dualism. Or what it does is it's still spiritually dualistic. But as Jesus puts it, it's the final illusion that dispels all our illusions. It's the final illusion that dispels all other illusions. And then from that point, it's easy to set it down too. It's the intermediate step that solves the continuity problem for us. The vision of oneness. So this has not been made clear. I mean, throughout the ages, there's been so much turmoil. You know, it's very difficult to look at the teachings of the East and get to get to this very clearly. It's very difficult, the teachings of the West, to get this clearly. So I've looked at, focused just on this vision of oneness. False witness is now witnessing to the vision of oneness, which then enables us ultimately to drop the false witness altogether. But we are not at a place where we can simply drop this false witness. If we did, we would be like Sri Anandamayi Ma or Amana Maharshi or Buddha. Okay, we're not there yet. Let's be honest. We are still immersed in spiritual dualism here on this planet. Immersed in it. We can't seem to live without it. Cannot seem to live without it. I mean, there's the entire sociological, political, spiritual spectrum of this planet is just saturated with spiritual dualism. So we can hear, you know, from Shankara, some of these great, you know, what was it, Ashtavarka, Gita, some of these great teachings and teachers are saying, you know, drop the whole thing, the false witness, everything. Be completely indifferent to the world. Nothing, no desire, and absolutely nothing. Well, yeah, in India, you could sit there in a cave as a light body for, you know, and walk around, you know, naked, without eating any food, and be completely indifferent to everything. It doesn't work. That doesn't work here at this time. Okay, so we are in this. We have a great necessity to focus on the false witness, witnessing to the vision of oneness, equal presence of the light, the formless light, equal presence of the formless light, vision of oneness. We have an extreme need for that step to take place. That's what I focused on. We don't need to try and trump it by saying, yeah, we'll drop that too. That's a trick that spiritual dualism uses here, okay? What happens is, when we try to get to this vision of oneness, false witness, vision of, on the vision, witnessing the vision of oneness instead of the world, okay? Those spiritual dualists say, yeah, that's cool too, but there's another step. And you need to do the other step. Well, that other step is too difficult. It's not going to happen right here, okay? So then that throws us off of the vision of oneness, false witness to the vision of oneness. It throws us off of that, and we reject that. We say, oh, that's not where it's at. I need to do something higher than that. And so we don't do that all-important intermediate step, and then we're basically totally vulnerable to spiritual dualism, divine feminine, you know, matriarch and big mother, heal the world, solve all the world's problems, all that nonsense, which is just a hoax. We're vulnerable to it. This is what I've seen has happened in the world. You get this. Yeah, that's great. Really happy. It's a great step you've taken. But you know, there's a lot of steps past that. There's still a lot of work you need to do. That's not true. That's part of the hoax of light. Okay, that's part of the hoax of light, saying that the remedy to all this, it's not that important. There's bigger remedies. You know, you need no. Because the continuity fear doesn't allow that ultimate remedy to take place in this situation that we're in. I mean, theoretically it's possible, but just try living like Anandamayi Ma did. She didn't identify with her body at all. People had to take care of her. To her, the body didn't even exist. Couldn't even feed herself. She couldn't even feed herself. She took no thought for the body whatsoever. And it required enormous effort to keep her here in the world. There was a testimony to the non-dual nature of the high spiritual teachers of India, that people are willing to do that. They're willing to do it. Absolutely no identification with the body or the world whatsoever. None. She knew that there was nothing wrong ever, anywhere. Impossible. So people had to take care of her. In the modern world like this, you know, good luck with that. Theoretically, it could happen. I hoped it would happen. I was willing to help out, but it hasn't happened. And I don't think that's what we're supposed to be focused on, okay? We're supposed to be focused on the intermediate step. All right, that's what Jesus and the Holy Spirit has led me to. Forget about Sri Anandamayi Ma, because someone like that is not likely to appear in this world at this point. If it does, fine, but our goal is still the same. Our goal is still the same, which is to this intermediate step, false witness, witnessing to the vision of oneness. We're not trying to go beyond that. And I see these very clever teachers in the world trying to incorporate. They say, yeah, but go further. And when you try to go further, you become completely vulnerable to spiritual dualism and the idea of prosperity consciousness here, healing the world, making the world like a heaven, a better place, etc. Now, Anandamayi said, I have no desire to do anything to fix the world. There's nothing to fix here. So I got no interest in building hospitals or temples or charity works or doing anything. I'm just here to remind you this is all a scam. Everything is fine. Everything is perfect. You're just deceiving yourselves. Your immortal spirit, deathless, formless, immortal spirit. So, was not teaching prosperity consciousness. Was not teaching how to make yourself rich, how to make yourself prosperous here. Prosperity. A lot of new thought went into prosperity teaching. Okay, a lot of it. And now that's coming into, now a lot of the non-dualistic teachings, Neo-Advaita, is going into prosperity consciousness. You know, the secret is part of it, all this stuff of, yeah, how can I get mine? How can I get the light to work for me? How can I get the light to make me happy here? How can I get the light to make me prosperous? This is spiritual dualism. This is more and less. The idea of more or less is spiritual dualism. And it's rampant. It's rampant right now in the world. So, the teachers that you want to look for are the ones who are the false witness is witnessing to the vision of oneness. And so they draw you to that because that's the remedy. That is the remedy. Be a lot of people in the world this time that can actually, you know, be drawn to that. But some can, men and women, absolutely. Yeah. Because keep in mind that we're spirit, we're not male or female. So some spirits are saying, wait a minute, I don't like this, my attention is going on this divine feminine healing world. Say, whoa, 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 wait a minute. I'm tired of this stuff. Haven't we been there before? Haven't we been there before? Absolutely we have. It just repeats, it repeats, it repeats. It just shuffling the deck, just shuffling the deck. Light keeps shuffling the deck. And Spirit's saying, well, wait a minute. No, wait a minute. You're not so fast here. I'm tired. I don't want this shuffle. I don't care if Light is telling me that I have a female body or Light's telling me I have a male body. That's all nonsense. That's all nonsense. You know, it's my attention that's important. Where is my attention? Spiritual attention. Now I tried to shift my attention this morning off of the world, and wow, you know, the attempt to pull it back in, it keeps trying to go to some, you know, super gruesome, either some super violent or some super sexual situation. It keeps trying to pull your mind into that, like that's intense, you know, that's important or something. It's like, yeah, some atrocities here, atrocities. I say, whoa, no, what is that? That's where the attention. You know, that's where they're pulling your attention. So it's like, seems super consequential, super sick, something that needs to be healed, okay? The light tries to pull your attention, this dream tries to pull your attention to that which you think needs healing. For sure this needs healing. This is sick, this is depraved. You gotta do something about it. And you say, no, whoa, whoa, whoa. So you try to pull your attention off of it, and the attention, you know, gets pulled back, the false witness. But the false witness can turn its attention to the vision of oneness. Because we request this of the light. We request this of the light. It says, light, I want to drop this desire to be prime creator, but I have a continuity problem, therefore I request that I have this intermediate step, false witness. Excuse me, don't drop the false witness. Don't drop the false witness. Keep the false witness. Don't drop the basic format of the world. Keep that, but just now see the false witness is seeing equal presence of light everywhere. No matter what is happening, equal presence of light everywhere. That will dissolve the continuity fear. Well, I guess it's Saturday, so someone feels that they need to turn on their muscle car and, you know, bombard the neighborhood with it. Equal presence of light. Okay, this is the way. Now, not all New Thought teachers went into this, you know, divine feminine and all this type of thing that's turned on. You know, there's a lot of good teaching there. However, we're farther along now than that. We're way farther along. Because really, A Course in Miracles has been super helpful to get our attention to what needs to take place, really needs to take place. And as I see it, it's the false witness, which we think is us. You see, we can't drop it right now because we believe it's spirit. No, it's a false witness, a light that has made this false witness, that is presenting. False witness, we don't drop it, false witnesses, keep it. We don't drop the world, but we keep that as seeing the light, equal presence everywhere of the light. And we just abide in that, simply, we just abide in that. This is very doable. This is very doable, and the light will present it to us. If we request just this, only this, light will respond and present the vision of oneness to us. Absolutely. If we understand, we're not afraid, we understand this is what we have to do to solve the continuity problem, because we're not able to just completely set down not only the world, not only the patriarchy and the matriarchy and the divine male and the divine feminine and healing and fixing, not only set all that down in all form, but set down the witness to all of it, which we believe is believed as us. Just set it down like that. We're not ready to do that. Only a few extraordinary, you know, great beings like Jesus, Ramana Maharshi, Shankara, Buddha, Anandamayima, etc. are in that condition. Okay, so let's be realistic. Let's be practical here. Let's be practical. Don't fall for that old trick of duality, spirituality, saying, hey, you need to be idealistic and try to be like Buddha. No, we need to take this intermediate step. Forget about all this argue, what is Buddha mind, you know, all this kind of stuff. It's essentially nirvana, abiding in nirvana. But as they say, there's a step even beyond nirvana, as Anandamayima said. There's the bliss of samadhi nirvana, which is actually the false witness, witnessing the vision of oneness. Equal presence of light, which is nirvana, not moving. Okay, the equal presence of light everywhere is completely still. She said, there's beyond that, there's the great bliss. But she says, if you're in the great bliss, you can't stay here, really. It's very difficult to stay here. And she had a very difficult time staying here in the body. Needed help. And she wasn't always in the great bliss. She identified with the bliss just as maintained to stay here. When she went into the great bliss, her whole body would be like a frozen ice cube. It's unbelievable. And it's very difficult to bring her out of it. It'd take days and days and days, sometimes a week, until she was able to come back into just the bliss of the oneness of the light here. And if people were not interested in this intermediate step of false witness to the vision of oneness, then she would lapse into the great bliss, and her body would drop like dead. It would be like frozen. No pulse, no heartbeat, nothing. She'd be like frozen. Completely inert and frozen. Okay, and then they'd have to take great steps to bring her back. They'd sing a lot of religious songs. They have to get their focus back on desiring this intermediate step, and then her body would thaw out and she'd be able to function and talk with them. But for a while she wouldn't even be able to talk to them. So this is extreme. We need to be like Sri Anandamayima. Forget it. We need the intermediate step. Absolutely, we all do. Let the avatars take care of being avatars. We're not avatars, okay? We have a continuity problem. She did not have a continuity problem, all right? Shankara did not have a continuity problem. Jesus did not have a continuity problem. Buddha did not have a continuity problem. We have a continuity problem. So our remedy, medicine, is the false witness viewing the vision of oneness. That's our remedy. all these other teachers who want to tell us not, forget them, forget about them, forget them, male, female, whatever, forget it. If they're playing that dualistic game like, hey, you can do better than that, you should just aim higher, or this is just a step along the way, blah, blah, blah. No, it isn't. It's not just a step along the way. It is the step. There's only one step beyond that, and God takes that step. It's not up to us, actually. That's what Jesus said. It is God itself that takes the final step for us. The one step that we can take and need to take is this vision of oneness, false witness, putting its attention on the vision of oneness. Now, the false witness and the vision of oneness is all a play of light. It's not us, really. So it's the play of light that does this for us. We, as spirit, need to request it. The false witness doesn't request it. The divine feminine doesn't request it. None of it's spirit that requests it. Say, light, I want to set this whole thing, this whole play, I want to see it's all fraudulent. I want to be able to set it down entirely, but I need this intermediate step in order to overcome this continuity fear that I have. So I want this. The false witness now, I want his attention to be on the vision of oneness. And Jesus tells us that the light will do this for us. So I believe that. I believe that. I trust in it. That's been my aim. Hasn't happened yet, but I had a couple of instances where it did happen. I know it's there. It can happen. I needed to put it in the right context here and get past some of this stuff, this spiritual duality, essentially, in the world. That is just claiming that it's unassailable. You know, it's wrapping itself in the robes of modernity, you know, is what it's really doing. Yeah, you know, that's an intense dualism, isn't it? How can anyone assail maternity? You know, it's like the pregnant young mother giving birth to a new age. How can anybody be against that? You see what I'm saying? And so that's been extremely problematical, actually, for everyone. Because it just keeps us, the witness, this false witness, bound to this false hoax play. The scam of a play of conflict and light and things need to be healed, etc. It keeps a false witness riveted to that. And we need to say no. False witness to attention to the vision of oneness. Equal presence of light. All this other stuff is fraudulent. It gives the impression of unequal presence of light, unequal response of light. It is not true. That is not true. And how can we function as God created us to function, believing even a tiny doubt that maybe the light is not equally responsive or some way? It's impossible. We cannot function. So we have to get over this delusion and recognize that the light has always been equally present, equally responsive. All of this was just a play of vain imaginings, conjured up, you know, that this has all been a scam, a hoax on us, self-deception. We have to get used to this fact. We have to let it sink in. Wow. It's like, wow. We have to sort of decompress from this. It's like coming up from the depths of the ocean to the surface. You got to decompress. Sometimes you need to, you know, kind of give yourself time to, you know, so you don't get the bends, the spiritual bends. You don't want to get the spiritual bends. I've been getting some of the spiritual bends because I've been ascending so fast, you know, up to the surface here. It's like, you know, wow, you know, it really intense, very intense. But very doable. So for those who you know, are ready to really tell light, this is what I want now. This is what I desire. Light will provide it. And then don't back off and say, whoa, what's this? How do I fit this into new thought, to unity, to new thought, to even A Course in Miracles, to whatever, Vita, non-dual, how do I fit this in? You don't have to fit it in at all. Because your attention is no longer on any of that stuff. It's no longer on words. Okay? It's no longer on definitions. Any definition, any word, is not on any spiritual teaching, is not on any non-spiritual teaching. It's not on any spiritual definition, not on any non-spiritual definition, except it's the false witness on the vision of oneness, equal presence of the light everywhere, at all time, all moments. It's only on that. It's beyond words, okay? So you've left all of that behind, with the attention isn't turned from that. It does not fit into new wine, does not fit into old wineskins, including A Course in Miracles, including New Thought, including the all this vita non-dual blah blah blah, New Age. It doesn't fit at all. Doesn't fit at all. It's wordless. It's definitionless. It's simply attention of the wit of the false witness. False witness, false attention, false vision of oneness. However, that remedies the continuity problem. And that we are willing, we finally willing to accept, it's impossible for light to even consider that light is not perfect, that all of God's creation is absolutely flawlessly perfect. There can never be any such thing as a conflict or need to heal or fix anything. Totally, absurdly, whimsically impossible. And to completely accept that is the final step. We're not ready for it. We have to focus on just melting this continuity fear away. False witness, false attention, on false vision of oneness, right? It's still a presentation by light of equal presence with all its form, still needing to be witnessed, okay? It's not a problem. Jesus said, don't worry, it's not a problem. It's the last illusion that dispels all other illusions. I trust that, I believe in it. The reasoning behind it is accurate. So hopefully there'll be this new teaching, this new teachers arise that are just focused on just this, and you have the option to do this, and maybe an option to ascend to a different dimension, death-free realm, as this world crumbles into just absolute extreme spiritual dualism with all of the hell that plays out to keep your attention on it. Right. See, our attention is lagging. Light says, oh boy, I better, you know, amp it up here. I better ramp it up. Hey, folks, everything's going to be healed. You know, we got the healers here. Don't worry. We're giving birth to a new age. Everything. So, yeah, it justifies the attention, the witness's attention, all this, right? So that the real witness, spirit, says, oh yeah, okay. Yeah, I can see. I'm this whole prime creator, me being this prime creator thing, yeah, it still seems legitimate here. It still seems legitimate. That's what's happening, you know. Light is just cranking up the illusion mill here, pulling out all the stops, wrapping it in the robes of modernity, you know. It's hardballing it. It's really hardballing the whole situation. So I pray. My intention is for you know, teachers who have their false witness, false attention, false vision of oneness. It's all. I mean. Attention on the vision of oneness, which is again quote unquote because it's being perceived by a false witness, right? But we'll just use the term vision of oneness. Witness, false witness, attention on the vision of oneness, who literally are doing that. That's where the attention is. That's how the dream is playing out. That's the dream within the dream that Jesus talks about. Actually are living that dream within the dream. That's where the attention is. Can be helpful. Now it may seem like a radical thing to do and to be like disloyal. How can I turn away from this maternity, you know, that is taking place? Ready to give birth to the new age, and all the midwives are here. You know, all the midwives are here, hovering around the queen about to give birth to the new age, etc. How can I possibly not pay attention to that? It's so ultimately important, etc. It seems like a totally iconoclastic thing to do, to turn your attention away from that. But no, absolutely turn your attention away from that. Turn your attention to vision of oneness, which solves the continuity problem. It's very important that this get going fast. I'm pushing. Still don't have it. It's entirely, you know, my responsibility. It's entirely my own continuity fear that why I don't have it. There's no question about it. But I'm still pushing for it, still working for it, you know, still possible, still viable. We need it. Even small numbers will help. Even small numbers will help. then once we see that this is the true alternative, the true way, then more people say, hey, yeah, I think I like that. I don't really want to keep my, you know, attention to all this stuff. It's just, I just thought there's an alternative to it, right? So there's been a big co-opting of the teaching that comes in the world. It gets co-opted. This play of light co-opts it. It says, sure, here it is. This is the answer. This is where your attention needs to be on, this co-opted, distorted version of it. And we think, oh, okay, we got to go along with that. And not true. It's our continuity fear that makes us feel we need to go along with it. Embrace the continuity fear. Say, this is my problem. How do I solve a continuity problem? Request from the light, look, I want to accept this intermediate step. False witness, attention on the vision of oneness is the intermediate step. Solves my continuity problem. That's all that I want. I don't want anything else. Don't want anything else. I don't want to be a healer. I don't want to be a fixer. I don't want to solve the problems in the world. I don't want to be quote unquote famous, you know, historic. I was a great saint that helped usher in the new age, and I've done all this wonderful healing work in the world. I don't want to be that. That's nonsense. That makes things worse. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Okay. So, all right. So I'm pushing, as you see, can see, I am really pushing things here, right? This is very iconoclastic. I mean, it's heresy, really. It's modern heresy, for sure. It's great to be heretical to deception, self-deception, isn't it? To spiritual duality. By all means, be heretical to spiritual duality. By all means. All right? Okay. It's enough said. I will see how I can, you know, bring it through even more. Great. That's it.